You know, being in Gettysburg, celebrating, or commemorating is the more appropriate word, the 150th anniversary of the Battle of Gettysburg, was for me just a lifetime honor. A civics teacher and a history buff, specifically Minnesota's role. So to be there where the first Minnesota men stood, to be where they fought, especially on days 2 and 3, for me was moving. I mean, it was emotional to rededicate those monuments to the action those men took on those 2 days. And I think the highlight for me was walking the route of the charge on day 2, and then having our tag, General Nash, exchange handshakes and pleasantries with the Adjutant General from Alabama, General Smith, and just to sort of show where we've come as a country in 150 years. And while we had those deep rifts then, we're brothers in arms again now.
Everybody, friends from Minnesota and from other parts of the planet, my name is Mark Ritchie. I have the honor of serving as Minnesota Secretary of State and co-chairing our state Civil War Commemorative Task Force with State Representative Dean Erdahl.
My name is Daryl Sanis. I'm with the Minnesota Civil War Task Force. And in a few minutes, the First Minnesota is going to lead us down to Plum Run. We're going to recreate the charge of the First Minnesota.
You know, you read in all these history books about the heroisms and the Battle of Gettysburg and all this stuff, but it's really no hype with the First Minnesota. I firmly believe that the Battle of Gettysburg was on the line, and so was the nation, if these guys didn't do their duty. So Hancock rode up this way in this area. He saw a group of men, bayonets fixed, already in line, helping to support a battery. And he knew that he had to sacrifice them to buy 5 minutes. 5 minutes, that's all he needed, because he knew more reinforcements were coming. Yeah. He said, you know, he hated doing it, but it had to be done. So he rode up this way, and he yelled out, "My God, is this all the men we have? What regiment is this?"
"The First Minnesota, General."
"Detail."
"Hold."
"Right, face." "Forward, march." "Right of the men to the left." "My file, right, march." "Pivot around, parallel to the fence." "Good." "Left, left, left." "Get out to where we're right down from the monument." "Left, left, left." "Short, choppy steps. Nice and slow and steady." "Guard, hold." "Present, arms."
So, well, thanks for coming down to at least being close to Plum Run. I certainly want to extend my appreciation to my battle buddy, 150 years later, Major General Perry Smith from the great state of Alabama. As you all know, the First Minnesota faced the Wilcox Regiment. A number of regiments from Alabama that fought valiantly that day with the 1st Minnesota. And General Smith was gracious enough to travel from Alabama to be here for this special day for us.
You know, the 1st Minnesota and Plum Run is many times overshadowed by the 20th Maine and Little Round Top. But if it wasn't for the 1st Minnesota, we wouldn't be standing here, I'm sure, we wouldn't be standing here as citizens of the United States of America.
"Three cheers and a tiger for the great state of Alabama. Hip hip!
Hooray!
Hip hip!
Hooray!
Hip hip!
Hooray!
Hooray!
ready for a very emotional experience, but I wasn't prepared to be as changed inside and to also be with so many other people experiencing a kind of level of change and just opening up. And so for me, it wasn't just history, it wasn't just you know, thinking about family and that kind of thing. It was really thinking about the nation and about who we are as people and where we're going.
You know, I really enjoyed sketching things out there. I haven't drawn anything in 40 years since I was in high school. And my husband sketches things because he's an artist. And for me, sketching McPherson's Barn, sketching Little Round Top from Devil's Den, made that experience just even more real to me, I think, because I was actually not just taking a picture, but spending the time and noticing all the details.
Should we pull it to the back? Let's just drop it. One, two, three, drop. So there we go.
That was definitely a high point too, although I have been living with that painting for a number of months now, so I'm pretty familiar with it. But it was very exciting to be able to show that to everybody. And he, of course, has come home and has been reworking parts of it based on new knowledge. I mean, there's always new knowledge, which is great. And also from just being there, seeing the way the hills were behind Plum Run and things like that. So it will be done shortly.
Oh, it was a great museum on Seminary Ridge, the old Lutheran Theological Seminary there, going up on the cupola and being able to get a real sense of what General Buford was seeing on July 1st, June 30th of 1863.
To go to the new museum, the Seminary Ridge Museum, was a thrill.
I have to say, climbing to the top of the Lutheran Seminary and standing out at the cupola and seeing where the generals could see the whole countryside, that was a high point, literally and figuratively.
It's hard to explain. I'm not Irish whatsoever, and I had no relatives that fought in that unit, but I've read quite a bit on the unit and stuff, and I thought of what they did and throughout countless battles, like at Bloody Lane at Antietam. Their assault there, I thought they're a fascinating unit, and what fascinates me is that they're foreigners fighting for their adoptive country, and that's always something that's captivated me.
And Gettysburg, to me, had a feeling that phrase that we use, out of many, one, Gettysburg is a place to stand and view what it takes, the sacrifice it takes sometimes to find that more perfect union.
And Pickett's Charge.
Watching the couple thousand people come across towards Cemetery Ridge from Seminary Ridge in Pickett's Charge, I thought was very meaningful as well. What I particularly enjoyed being able to do was, as they got closer, first of all chanting Harper's Ferry at them, and then being able to chant Fredericksburg, Fredericksburg, Fredericksburg.
A number of you have asked me today what must feel unique or challenging or different or tough or whatever to be a descendant of somebody who fought in this amazing conflict. And so I thought probably one of the things I could do, I brought along some snippets from my great-great-grandfather's memoirs. And I thought that perhaps more than anything I could say, because I can't say much to add to what was done here, it might be nice to personalize the Battle of Gettysburg, the attack of the 1st Minnesota, with the experiences of a survivor. Christopher enlisted on the first day, April 16th. He was 27 years old. He enlisted as a private in Company D. And by July 2nd of 1863, he was in command of Company D as its first lieutenant. I just want to read to you his, it's only about a page long, but his view of the charge. And this is from his perspective on the ground. It was late in the afternoon. The victorious Confederates were moving rapidly, driving the defeated Union troops in the front and were moving directly to the position that the 1st Regiment had occupied. At this particular moment, no other troops were in reach. General Hancock, taking in the situation, rapidly rode up to the battery. As you heard, we were protecting a battery at the time, accompanied by one aide. Calling to Colonel Colville, commanding the 1st Regiment, he said, "What regiment is this?" "The 1st Minnesota," replied Colville. "Is it possible this is all the troops I have here?" said Hancock. Pointing to the advancing column, Hancock ordered, "Colonel, charge those lines." The enemy was now so close that they could be reached by musketry fire. In making his charge, the regiment was thrown largely in front of the artillery, which was consequently obliged to withhold its fire. While the infantry was in front of our movement where the charge was made, the ground was inclined. The position of the charging forces of the enemy being on high ground, the lay of the ground protected us considerably from the enemy's fire. The regiment charged down the incline. The enemy, be it understood, was on an elevation. It's kind of repetitive. Now we came to close action in what is known as a ravine. But the enemy's position being high, the shots went mostly over our heads. And it is a matter of record that most of the killed and wounded were hit in the upper part of the body. Before reaching the ravine, Colonel Colville fell with two wounds, one in the foot and the other in the left lung. When he fell, he ordered the regiment to retire. At this time, the regiment had reached the ravine. In the charge, the position of the enemy threw the right wing of the regiment closer to the enemy's line than the left wing. Consequently, this wing received the effects of fire first and suffered a great loss. Company D, that's the company in which he was command, was the third company from the color company on the left wing. Upon reaching the ravine, we halted and engaged the enemy in our immediate front. The right wing, being more crippled in the first firing than the left, retired a little in advance of the left. Consequently, the left wing had more or less of a flank fire from the right. At this time, or within a very few minutes, and while in this position, Company D lost 3 men killed and 10 or 12 wounded. I received a slight wound, which was very painful, but not of serious nature. While here, my attention was concentrated on the front, and I did not notice the colors go to the rear. Sergeant Martin called my attention to the fact that the right was retiring. I immediately ordered my company to the rear, and we fell back on a line with the battery. At this time, the battery was doing a very effective service, firing a shot a minute. Retiring, we fell to the left and right of the battery, this giving the battery an open field of fire. About this time, reinforcements reached the field. Christopher goes on to say, the nature of my, and this goes to my feelings for today and yesterday and tomorrow. The nature of my wound on the second was from a gunshot, from a mini ball. The ball went through my blouse and cut a little memorandum book in my blouse pocket, split the lead pencil, and cut through my clothes, going through the woolen shirt, but it did not enter my body. It left it black and blue and badly bruised from the concussion, and was quite sore and painful for several days, but in no way disabled me from my duty. I remained with the regiment in command of my company throughout the campaign. He got shot in the chest. You can imagine my sentiment going through the medical floor this morning and seeing what a chest wound would do. So as those answered to those of you who asked me what it feels like to be a descendant, I feel incredibly lucky. I'm reminded of how war is a matter of fortune, as well as training and preparation and all the other things that go into making. And I'm reminded what does fortune mean? I've been very fortunate in my life. My family has been very fortunate in my life. My great-great-grandfather came back from this conflict, went to Minneapolis, started a very successful business, had 8 children, all of whom were successful. So, you stole my thunder with the moment of silence, but good fortune is, it's really important as we visit these hallowed grounds to remember those who, on whom fortune did not smile.
And our whole tour of the site with the bus group led by these wonderful men who have who are the battlefield guides, it just, all of it together, and I think the group experience is what really made it for me.
Lay down on the traffic, said it's the worst day they've ever seen on the battlefield. Everybody got walking shoes on. They say there is nowhere to park anywhere near the Minnesota Monument. Plus, two of my guide colleagues just took 2 buses from Minnesota, and they said they had to just drive by. They said there's around 15,000 people on Little Round Top at any one time. We won't even get near it, or we might get views of it from a distance. I'm kind of afraid to attempt it to get boxed in, but we're going to have a great time anyway. So none of these problems. So you know what? We're going to do whatever we can do, right? So, yeah, maybe. Anyways, we're from Minnesota. We'll kick them out. We charged them off the field once. We can do it again.
I'll go to tears. Absolutely honored to take Minnesota people out to remember the charge of the first Minnesota.
To be able to be in the cemetery with everybody, even in the rain, it was absolutely wonderful.
Everybody okay?
Yeah.
All right, we'll move. Initially, they buried 3,512 bodies here. 979 are unknown. Over 1,600 are unknown, really. 979 are completely unknown. And when we say partially unknown, we know his regiment, you know, or the state that he came from, but we know nothing else. All right? All right, you're doing the flags.
Great.
All right, blah, blah. Here's the Minnesota urn, first monument put on the field.
And they said that residents from around the area had adopted virtually all of the monuments, and it's their job to take care of them, notify the national partner if they see any problems, and basically keep them clean and neat. But when they pulled out their notebook and looked at this, no one had ever adopted the urn.
About 2 years ago, we heard that there was an Adopt-a-Monument program at Gettysburg, and we went to check. And of course, the two main monuments had been adopted, so we inquired about the urn and found out that that had not been adopted at National Cemetery, and in fact, had not been planted with flowers for many years. So we thought that was a wrong that needed to be corrected, so we adopted the monument and created a fund. And we've partnered with a woman in Gettysburg who each year or each spring pulls money out of the fund and buys flowers for at a local nursery and plants them and then checks on it from time to time. And it was neat for us as we got to meet the woman. We were in Gettysburg for the 150th and got a chance to talk to her and talk about her involvement long term. So I think at least for the next several years we're in good shape there.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Want to see where we can get to Gettysburg?